Hello students, welcome to today's lecture of 27th of July 2020, and today the lecture is going to be about semester 1's prose 1 lesson. Semester 1 for UG BA, BCom, BBA, BSc first year general English course curriculum, the short fiction The Curve in the Sky, written by James Thurber. We are going to look at this particular lesson in detail, but I would be teaching you how to do a reading comprehension. How do you read? So refresh your reading skills. How do you do it? What are the techniques? And I'm going to take you through this particular lesson. I am Bangla Bharati, Associate Professor of English, Vivekananda Government Degree College, Vidyanagar, Hyderabad. Let me just share the PowerPoint with you. Just give me a minute. If you have your textbooks with you, I want you to actually look at your textbooks. It's always better you have your textbooks with you. Yes. I hope you can see. This is your lesson, The Curve in the Sky, Semester 1, prose text for UG students of Usmania University. Curve in the Sky is written by American writer James Thurber. James Thurber, you can see, this is his picture. He's a very well-known humor writer. And he is very well known for his drawings and sketches, the illustrations, which were widely published in the New York Times. And he's quite popular. He was very well accepted also by the American people. And there is a yearly award, James Thurber Best Cartoon Award, given every year to the American youth for the best illustration and best humoristic caricature or cartoon. About the writer, James A. Thurber is an American humorist. He was born in 1894, grew up in Columbus, Ohio, and in a rather eccentric family. Why eccentric family? I'll tell you a little later. He worked for various newspapers in Columbus, Paris, and New York before finally joining the New Yorker, for which he produced most of his essays, short stories, columns, and drawings. His father, Charles L. Thurber, was a small-time clerk and a minor politician. But his mother, Mary Agnes Thurber, was a homemaker, and she was the one who instilled humor in Thurber. When Thurber was a little boy, he lost an eye while playing with his brother. And that made it very difficult for him to take part in any of the sports activities at school. But then this difficulty, this handicap, he slowly overcame, and he put all his energies into his creative endeavors. Thurber developed his creative writing skills when he was a young boy. And this accident that happened, it became a boon for his writing career, and his talent came out in full vigor when he joined the New Yorker magazine as an editor. Who introduced him? His friend and fellow contributor E.E. White recommended him. And White was the person who recognized his talent for drawing and published some of his illustrations in the magazine, which of course was well acknowledged by readers across the American continent. In 1913, James Thurber joined the Ohio University, but he could never graduate because his eyesight was poor. So he couldn't compete with the other students. So he dropped out of the university. He could never complete his degree and started working as a code clerk, first in Washington and then in France. His writing career as an author started in 1930s and continued for 3 decades, during which time he wrote many short stories, fictional memoirs, fables, as many as 75 fables he wrote, and then prose type humorous essays, a biographical memoir, and short stories for small children, school children, a lot he has written. And Thurber's work, the experts say that it's described as a mixture of craziness, fantasy, and irony. He's a sharp social commentator of his times, during the American times, how the family system was, how the youth was, how the society was. He was a sharp social commentator with a strong moral concern. His style is elegant and genteel. Many of his essays and short stories deal with the triumph of the moral values. And James Thurber, his style, as critics say, is elegant and genteel. Not only that, most of his essays and short stories deal with the triumph of moral values of the normal people in the world of mass media, psychoanalysis, and sexual revolution. James Thurber died in the year 1961. That was because of pneumonia. Pneumonia led to a stroke and he passed away. But he is very well known for his deadpan style of storytelling. Now, what is this technique, deadpan style? This is a dry humor or dry wit humor. And it is a deliberate display of emotional neutrality. I mean, there is no emotion showed. When a writer is writing a story, from the writer's side, there is no emotional upheavals, nothing. He's very neutral. With an absolute deadpan face, with no emotion, he would be giving the story. And this is commonly is a form of comic delivery, in contrast with the ridiculousness of the subject matter. The delivery is meant to be blunt, ironic, iconic, or apparently unintentional. So dead comedy is more a tactic that can be used in short intervals or stretched across a comedian's entire career. And deadpan dry humor is very well known Thurberian style. And James Thurber, you can see the introduction given in your textbook, American Humorist. One second, let me just... Yeah. After working as a reporter for various newspapers, he finally joined the New Yorker magazine and established himself as an essayist and a short story writer. His famous works are The Seal in the Bedroom, My Life and Hard Times, and The Middle-Aged Man on the Flying Trapeze. These are very, very popular. He's very well known for his cartoons. And the Thurber Prize for American Humor was established in his honor. Coming to your text, The Curb in the Sky, it is a story of a couple, Dorothy and Charlie Deschler. Dorothy has this weird habit of constantly interrupting other people when they speak in order to correct their mistakes or finish their sentences. Very, very hyper kind of a girl. Her husband, Charlie, on the other hand, he loves telling stories. So there is a clash of personalities between the husband and wife, which over time breaks the husband, the former. In order to avoid being interrupted by his wife, Charlie starts weaving fantastical tales of dreams. But then eventually he loses his mind and ends up in an asylum. At the end of the story, Charlie seems utterly defeated as Dorothy intrudes even into his fantasy world. Now we are going to look at this story, but before that, I want you to think about these questions. When someone speaks to you, do you pay attention or listen very casually? How do you feel when you're speaking and someone interrupts you continuously? Is it a good habit to correct others constantly? Now, I want you to think of these questions, because these questions, in a way, form the lead to the prose text, the story, The Curb in the Sky. So when someone is speaking to you, do you pay enough attention or do you listen? Ar chalta hai, this person is going to speak like that, or I know what he's going to speak. So you interrupt and you jump into conclusion, you complete their sentences. When somebody does to you the same thing, how do you feel? If somebody is interrupting you constantly without allowing you to finish your sentences, how do you feel? Is it a good habit actually to correct others continuously, constantly? will think about it and now we'll look at the text. I have divided this text into 5 parts. In fact, 6 parts. Each part has questions that you need to answer. Now read the questions, note them down, then read the passage to find the answers. To read the questions, I'll give you 2 minutes, 5 minutes to read the passage. So this is how usually a reading comprehension is done. You read the questions and you will read the passage, because without any purpose, you can't read a passage. The questions, you will find the answers in the passage. Shall we start then? If you have your notebook, get your notebook. Otherwise, you pause the video for a while. Go get your things. See that you're in a quiet and silent room, undisturbed. Get your pencil, pen. And if you have your textbook with you, nothing like it. It's better. So we will start now. Part 1, the first 2 paragraphs of your text. Questions are, when Charlie Deschler announced his marriage, what were people's reactions? What did Dorothy begin when she was young? Why were people annoyed? What did her parents think of this mannerism? What did they do? Now these are 5 questions. When Charlie Deschler announced that he's going to marry Dorothy, what were people's reactions? What did they say? And what did Dorothy begin when she was very young? Why were people annoyed? What did her parents think of this mannerism? And what did they do? I'll give you a close-up view of the text. Okay, look at it. I'll watch the time. I'll give you 5 minutes time for you to go through the text and find the answers. Your time starts now. Two minutes over. The new words which you haven't heard of before could be post hoc. When Charlie Deschler announced he was going to marry Dorothy, someone said, what did someone say? That was your first question, but the post hoc, what does it mean? Post hoc is after the event, or post haste is as fast as possible. These are 2 new words. Spinach is your palak. So look at the questions once again. When Charlie Deschler announced his marriage, what were people's reactions? Somebody said he will lose his mind post haste. Then somebody else said post hoc, that is after the event. Post haste is as fast as possible. Very quickly he's going to go mad. Somebody said no, not that quickly. After the marriage, after post hoc, he will, after the event, he will lose his mind. Okay, that was people's reaction. What did Dorothy began when she was young? Dorothy had begun when she was quite young to finish sentences for people. That means before somebody finished talking, she would finish for them. And why were people annoyed? Because sometimes she finished it wrongly. So people were annoyed. If you finished correctly, people were annoyed even more. What did her parents think of this mannerism? They initially thought, it was so cute. My daughter is so smart. She's so sweet. And she, the mother used to call up the father at the office and say, you know what Dorothy did today? I was about to say something. She finished my sentence before I could complete. She knew what I was going to say. Such a good mannerism. And the father, he told people in his office, his colleagues in his office, that his daughter is very, very smart. That's what they did. They told everyone they met and they were very, very happy about their girl's mannerism. This is about the first two paragraphs. Shall we move on to the next paragraph? Yeah. Next paragraph. When Dorothy grew up, the third paragraph. What happened when Dorothy grew up? Questions. What happened when Dorothy grew up? What effect did she have on gentlemen? What did she do in her late teens? What did most of her admirers initially do? What kind of a person was Charlie Deschler? Why did he not listen to the warnings of his friends? Seven questions. I'll give you 2 minutes time. Read it. I think I'll give you a close-up view of it. Okay, this is the close-up. Read it. I'll give you 2 minutes. I'll keep the time for you. Your time starts now. New words here are menace, M-E-N-A-C-E. It means something that causes serious damage, harm, or danger. Menace is something that causes severe damage, harm, or danger. Stirred, S-T-I-R-R-E-D, stirred them emotionally means they were attracted, their emotions grew up. But wearing something down is to make someone feel very tired and less able to deal successfully with a situation. That is wearing somebody down. Instructive means serving to instruct, enlighten, or inform. Teachers instruct you to do something. Or when you are using a new product, there is a list of instructions, how to use it. You have to follow the instructions. How to read it? I have given you instructions. This is instructive. Then sentimental. Characterized by great feeling or emotional, that is sentimental. Indians are very emotional and sentimental, that's what they say. Okay, with these new words, read it again, understanding the meaning. I'll give you one more minute, try to find the answers. 30 more seconds. Okay, what happened when Dorothy grew up? When Dorothy grew up, she became quite pretty, very beautiful. But then she was even more of a menace or a danger. What effect did she have on gentlemen? Gentlemen became very attracted to her and then attached to her. They fell in love with her, that means. And then what happened? Emotionally, she stirred them, but mentally she began to wear them down. She would make them very tired. What did she do in her late teens? She started correcting their English. If Arthur said no, this was something, then she used to correct. No, not was Arthur. Say were prepared. See? So what happened? What was the effect? Most of her admirers starting, they tolerated the habit because their interest was in her lovely face, the beautiful girl. But as the time passed, their interest remained only more of an instructive and sentimental. So they moved away, drifted towards a more dumb girls or less captious. Less captious? Captious means tending to find and call attention to faults. So somebody who will not pick up their faults. So towards such kind of girls, all these admirers drifted. So what did they do later? They all drifted. Now coming to Charlie Deschler, what kind of a person was he? He was an impetuous man. Impetuous, this is also a new word for you. It means acting without careful thought about the consequences. Very impulsive. So acting without any careful thought or thought about what will happen, the consequences, kind of impulsive. He was an impetuous man. And of the sweep them off their feet persuasion, he became engaged to Dorothy very quickly. And he married her in a very short time. Why did he not listen to the warnings of his friends? Because he thought that will come in the next paragraph. So this question will follow into the next paragraph. So to give you a quick recap, what kind of a girl was Dorothy? When Charlie Deschler said he's marrying Dorothy, all his friends were like shocked. They said, okay, he will lose his mind very soon. Somebody said, not very soon, later, after the event, he will lose his mind. Why? Because Dorothy was a girl, right from her childhood, she used to finish the other people's sentences. Initially, her parents thought, oh, very sweet. My daughter is very clever, very smart. The father used to tell everybody in the office also that his daughter is very smart. But then as she grew up, she became a very pretty and beautiful young woman. But then her nature of finishing other person's sentences became a menace. Young people were attracted to her. They fell in love with her. But then after a while, she used to start correcting their English and the grammar mistakes. So the boys slowly moved away from her. They drifted towards girls who will not correct their English, and they were happy. But Charlie Deschler was a guy who was very impetuous, and he fell in love with Dorothy and quickly married her. But then the friends gave the warning, but he did not listen to them. Why? You have to read the other paragraph, the second, third part of it. How was Charlie Deschler? What kind of a person was he? And how was their married life initially? Why didn't Charlie find out Dorothy's nature? When the author visited them, what did he notice? So these are the questions. So look at the last question. Why did he not listen to the warnings of his friends? He thought being deaf to the warnings of his friends, whose concern he regarded as mere jealousy. But he didn't know anything about Dorothy except that she has bright eyes, beautiful, and she's such a good looking girl. So she was very desirable. Now, How was Charlie Deschler and Dorothy's married life initially? Why didn't Charlie find out Dorothy's nature? When the author visited them, what did he notice? Okay, these are the questions. You have to find the answers, and I'll give you an enlarged view of the paragraph. Here it is. I'll give you exactly 3 minutes of time. Read it carefully and then find the answers. Glossary, some new words which you see here are great flowering. Flowering is the most productive period. The most productive period is that flowering. And Charlie was truly a recanter. What do you mean by recanter? Recanter is a person very good at telling stories in an interesting way. So Charlie Deschler was a good recanter. Recanter is the pronunciation. Courtship is a period when the boy woos a girl. They date for a certain period of time, that is courtship. Anesthetic is a drug that makes a person or an animal unable to feel the pain. When somebody is going under the knife, that is going for an operation, they give you anesthesia, right? Anesthesia, you won't feel the pain. Initially, love of Dorothy was like an anesthesia. After the effects, after a while, the anesthesia will wear out, and that's when you will realize the pain. That is anesthetic. Here. With the new meanings, try to read the paragraph again and try to find the answers to these questions. How was their married life initially? Why didn't Charlie find out Dorothy's nature? And when author James Thurber visited them, what did he notice? Yes. Another 2 minutes I'll give you. Read it carefully. Okay. The time is almost up. Look at the questions once again. And you need to give the answers. How was Charlie Deschler and Dorothy's married life initially? Initially, it was very good. She came to a good flowering because she did take to correct Charlie's stories because he was a person who traveled widely and experienced greatly. And he was a very good storyteller. And his English was very good. So Dorothy couldn't find fault with his English, with what's, ifs or grammar, because he spoke very good English. Why didn't he find Dorothy's nature initially? Because initially his language was perfect and she never corrected, and she listened with great awe to all the stories Travis, the husband, is narrating. So she was wide-eyed and literally interested in Charlie's stories. So Charlie didn't find out Dorothy's true nature. And when the writer visited, the writer wanted to call on is visit them after they were married, but then because he knew Charlie, but then when he couldn't visit initially, but when he did visit, that was the time when the anesthesia effect of Dorothy waned out. All the charms had started beginning to fade. And when he visited them, the conditions were all that he had feared. Because Charlie began to tell at the dinner about a motor trip they made, both of them made. And he wasn't sure of the towns and all that. Then Dorothy started interrupting them. Because almost everything that Charles said, Dorothy had interrupted and said, no, not that day. No, actually we went in the morning. No, not morning, not very early. It was at 7 o'clock. We drove almost around 100 miles, 200 miles. No, no, dear, not 200. It was only 180 miles because I saw on the mileage meter. Like that, she used to cut him down and she has cut him down and she started correcting the details of Charlie. This is about paragraph 2 and we'll look at paragraph 4. Now, what did Dorothy do when Charlie began his story? How would she often interrupt? What did the author notice when he called on them? Now, how do some husbands handle such a situation? What happened at the end of the second year of marriage? Okay. Now, what did Dorothy do when Charlie began his story? She has cut him and she started interrupting him about the details of the motor trip. Okay. How would she often interrupt with giving the details? And what did the author notice when he called on them? That the anesthesia and all that initial charm has faded away. And then Dorothy started interrupting Charlie's stories very often. Now, how do some husbands handle such situation? What happened at the end of the second year of the marriage? I'll give you a close-up view of this paragraph. So here it is. I'll give you some time, 3 minutes to read and understand. Calling on somebody is visiting them. Climax is a word, new word. That means the decisive moment of the story, the ending where a twist happens. That is climax. Tackler is like a tackler from behind is somebody who will come and attack from behind. Amiably is in a pleasant, friendly and easy manner to take. That is amiably. Outlandish, strange or extremely unusual. land is this, outlandish is, which is not practical, which is very strange and not belonging to this earth. So questions once again. What did the author notice when he called on them? How do some husbands handle such situations? What happened at the end of the second year of marriage? 3 minutes. I'll keep the time for you. Okay, 1 more minute. Quickly, the questions. Yes. So once or twice when the author called them, what happened? Dorothy would let Charlie take almost to the climax of the time when he's telling a story, when something happened, and then suddenly, like a tackler from behind, you see when you're in a rugby or in a soccer game, when you're about to take the ball and reach the goal, then suddenly somebody pulls you from back, right? That is a tackler. Like that, before the goal line, she used to pull him back. And then she would tell him, no, that is not the correct one. This is the correct one, darling. And whenever she says darling, that means she's differing from the person's story. So usually how do some husbands handle this kind of a situation? Some husbands will sit back. Okay, she is continuing, the wife is continuing, let her do it. They sit back in a friendly manner, they allow the wives to talk. And then after a while they say, okay, my wives know so much, karke, they will be very proud of if their wives interrupt and will let them go on with the story. They are the beaten kind of a husbands. But Charlie, he's an independent person. He could not become beaten and he would refuse to get beaten. So at the end of second year of marriage, what happened? When you visited the Deschlers, Charlie would suddenly begin with an outlandish story about a dream he had. Knowing that with everyday practical details, Dorothy will interrupt and correct the details. But who will correct the dreams? Dreams are my own, right? I can dream whatever I want to. How can somebody correct a dream? So he started telling stories about weird dreams, which are outlandish stories. Like, I thought I was running an aeroplane, he said. Aeroplane made of telephone wires and pieces of old leather. I was trying to make it fly to the moon, taking off from my window, bedroom window. Halfway the distance, however, I met a man who looked like a Santa Claus, but only that he was dressed in the uniform of a customs officer. He made me stop, and he was also in a plane made of a telephone wires. I pulled over to the cloud, and he said, "You can't go to the moon. You are the man who invented these wedding cookies. So look at the way he's weaving these stories, outlandish stories." So how do some husbands handle such situation? They will sit back. They will allow the wives to take over. They are the beaten kind of husbands. But then Charlie Deschler was not. At the end of the second year of their marriage, he started telling outlandish stories, weird stories, which look very, very unnatural, all born out of his fantasies, because he thought Dorothy will not be able to control his fantasy world. But then, was he right or was he mistaken? We'll look at the fifth paragraph. What stories did Charlie Deschler start narrating? That going on a plane from made of telephone wires, old pieces of leather, from his bedroom window, he moved on. What was his condition according to a psychiatrist? What happened after a month? Where was Charlie sent to? What did Joe Fultz write to the author? How did his eyes look after he was put in an asylum? So these are the questions that you have to find answers to. I'll have broken this down into two parts. So first part is, what stories did he narrate? How was Charlie's condition according to any psychiatrist? What happened after a month? Where was he sent to? What did his friend Joe Fultz write to the author? How did he look, his eyes look, after he was put in an asylum? You have to find the answers to these questions. So I'll give you 2 minutes to read. New words here are monomania. Monomania means too much interest in one thing. Too much interest in one or for one thing. That's all. That's monomania. I mean, whatever they believe, they keep on repeating the same thing again and again. That's monomania. Okay. Almost the time is up. We'll look at the questions. What was Charlie's condition according to any psychiatrist? It was, he started becoming mad. He was getting into a monomania where he's repeating only same thing again and again. After a month, what happened? His illness grew and then he was sent to an asylum, mental asylum, where his friend Joe Fools also went to the hospital and he wrote to the writer that finally he is now away from Dorothy, the mad woman. Hope he will look better. And he said earlier his eyes were like lost, like a neurotic, looking here and there, not focusing. But now his eyes are looking kind of with clarity. So he's finally gotten away from that woman. Now after a month, couple of weeks, the writer went to the asylum to visit Charlie. Now, when did the author visit Charlie? How did he appear? Who was there sitting with Charlie? What did Charlie begin to narrate? How did Dorothy interrupt him? Okay, I'll give you a close-up look of the last paragraph. When did he visit? How did he appear? Who was sitting there with Charlie? What did Charlie begin to narrate? How did Dorothy interrupt him? I'll give you 3 minutes to find answers. Here it is. New words here are big screened in porch. Porch is a kind of a veranda. Usually like a hall or a veranda, there is a screen or a shade put up where everything is ventilated, but the porch is a screened place, a covered veranda. Sanctuary, here it means a shelter from danger or hardship. When there is danger for their life, like deer sanctuary, lion sanctuary, tiger sanctuary, these are sanctuaries where a place, a shelter where they are protected. What is a curb? Curb is kind of a footpath or an edge. Okay, quickly, when did the author visit Charlie? A couple of weeks later. How did he appear? He was lying on a cot on a big screened in porch, looking wan and thin, like lost. And who was there sitting with Charlie? Dorothy was there sitting with Charlie near his bedside. And what did Charlie begin to narrate? He started a story. He looked very, very mad. And he started to tell a story about his trip to the moon. He got to the part where the man who looked like Santa Claus waved him to stop. And he was in a plane made of telephone wires too. And he said, I pulled over to the curb. And that's when Dorothy interrupted him and said, no, you pulled over to a cloud. There aren't any curbs in the sky. There couldn't be. You pulled over to the cloud. And what happened? Charlie sighed, turned aside in the bed and looked very sadly at the writer. But Dorothy, she looked at the author, but then with a very, very pretty smile. He always gets that part wrong. She said, this is where the story ends. So Quick summary. Charlie Deschler. Now the summary is a kind of, I made it into a fill in the blanks. Look at the words here. Acquainted is somebody whom you have met. Asylum is a mental hospital. Attractive, you know, cheerful, very happy. Correcting, always correcting. Impetuous is impulsive. Interrupting, cutting somebody short. Know all is like, you know everything, I know all. Protecting and qualified. So Charlie Deschler was an dash self-assured man. What is the word here? Impetuous. Before he married Dorothy. Since her childhood, Dorothy has been a what? Know-all, who cannot help correcting and instructing other people. As she is quite good-looking, men have always found her attractive. Yet, although she stirs them up emotionally, mentally, she completely weighs them down because of her habit of constantly correcting them. Despite his friend's warnings, Charlie Deschler marries Dorothy. At first, he succeeds quite well in dash himself from her constant interference. Protecting himself from her constant interference. Having traveled widely, he can talk about things and places she is not acquainted with, that she is not have any kind of knowledge with. However, as Dorothy gradually becomes familiar with her husband's stories, it is possible for her to revert to her old habit of interrupting and correcting. In vain, Charlie seeks refuge in his dreams and the only stories he can tell without fear of interruption, because only he can know about those stories. Gradually, they become the only life he has that he can call of his own. Finally, Charlie has to be taken to a mental asylum. Yet even there he is not safe from his wife. When the narrator goes to visit him, she sits by his bedside as bright and cheerful as ever. When Charlie starts to tell one of his remaining stories, she interrupts him. No, you pulled over to a cloud. There aren't any curves in the sky. The inevitable has happened. The dream has been repeated so often that Dorothy knows it by heart and feels completely dashed to add her own corrections. Completely qualified to add her own corrections. This is where your summary ends. The most important questions that are asked are, write a character sketch of Dorothy. Narrate in your own words Charlie's outlandish dream. What was the nature of the personality clash between the wife and the husband in the story? How did this clash affect Dorothy and Charlie as individuals? These are the questions that are often asked, but then you have to now understand the story from your point of view and then think of the ways where what went wrong. If somebody interrupts you just like that, if somebody keeps on correcting the grammar and the pronunciation, how do you feel? If somebody doesn't allow you to finish your sentences, how do you feel? All these you have to also think, that is what exactly Dorothy was doing without her knowledge. That became her nature, which the parents didn't correct. Later, nobody could correct. All her admirers, lovers ran away from her. Then poor Charlie, because he was an independent man, he couldn't afford to hurt his wife. He put up with it, but then he lost his mind and he ended up in the asylum. In the entire story, the way story is told has this deadpan kind of a storytelling. That means nowhere the writer shows his emotions. He only narrates the story as a factual things without his emotions being told or shown. This is the end of the story, and this is what the curb in the sky is all about. Curb is a footpath, and in the sky there are no footpaths, there are only clouds. So students, I hope you have understood the prose text and you will be able to answer all the questions. Do give it a reading. You can replay this video again. Try to answer all the questions, and tomorrow we will meet with another such lesson from your prose text, semester one. With this, we have completed the prose text of semester one, first unit, Curb in the Sky. Okay, good luck, students. And if you have any doubts, any questions, you can write in the remarks comment section down. I can revert to you. Good luck. Stay safe. Wear masks. Don't go out unnecessarily. Don't mingle and don't get into the crowded places. Maintain distance. Take all the precautions and stay home. Stay safe. See you later. Have a good time. Thank you so much.